It's more than a month now since a shipwreck tossed me up on this desert island. Happily, my solitude is lightened a bit by three fine companions, a dog, a goat, and a parrot, who have become my friends. The process of setting up housekeeping begins. The weeks pass quickly. I haven't time anymore to think about the unhappiness of being alone. I barricade the entrance of my cave with a solid row of stakes made from the trunks of banana trees. The island is only inhabited by harmless animals, but someday it may receive some dubious visitors. The seas are crisscrossed by pirates who choose desert islands like mine to stock up on water or repair damages. I construct a terrace so I can enjoy the ocean view and take some fresh air in the evening before going to bed. No matter where he is, an Englishman always winds up by living as though he were in England. I install an awning made of sailcloth on the terrace. The ladder is movable, like a drawbridge, and allows me to get over the wall. Now that I have my palace, I really feel like the king of this island. I'm less skillful in cabinet making than in building fortifications. I had no idea how difficult it is to make furniture until I tried it. You make the tables too high and the seats too low. However, after many tries, I've succeeded in making a chair which seems to me a miracle. I think I can be proud of myself, but even so, I feel a certain anxiety at the bottom of my heart. My work keeps me from thinking, but as soon as I stop, the horror of my situation becomes apparent. What if no one ever comes this way? Or if they come too late? Poor Robinson. From my terrace, I can contemplate the sea, the cause of all my troubles. And yet it seemed to smile at me when I embarked on Captain Darrick's ship. That day, I really thought the world belonged to me.
Mr. Bush?
Captain?
Have all hands come on deck right away to weigh anchor and hoist the sails.
Aye, aye, sir.
Cast off, weigh anchor, and hoist the sails. All right. Get up on deck, you loafers. Everybody up on deck.
Tommy's gone, that good old man.
Where's Tommy gone?
Tommy's gone, that good old man.
Cast off, weigh anchor.
They
dug his grave with a silver spade.
Hoist the mainsail and the gun.
His shroud of fatty silk was made.
Hoist the staysail and the parcel.
An able sailor, bold and true.
Hoist all along, John.
A good old bosun to his crew.
I was so happy I forgot about being seasick. And from then on, I never felt any discomfort at sea. I had become a sailor.
Well, Mr. Crusoe, are you happy with us?
Oh, yes, Captain. I still think it's a dream. Captain Darrick was very friendly toward me. He wanted to make me more than just a sailor. He wanted me to become a real navigator. He took great delight in teaching me, and I, up to now the lazy one, took equal delight in studying. I learned to keep a log, take our bearings, and sound the depths.
6 fathoms, Captain.
In short, I learned all the things necessary to be a navigator, so that one day, I might even be capable of commanding a ship. The whole crew treated me kindly, except Bush, the second mate, who hated me. I suppose he was jealous of the captain's friendship for me. But this unpleasant man was an excellent sailor who exercised great authority over the crew, and Captain Darrick was obliged to put up with him. At any rate, he couldn't take my side against his, which would have seriously jeopardized discipline on board.
Land to starboard, sir.
Mr. Crusoe?
I believe you've knocked over your chair.
For a second, I thought the captain would rebuke the second mate for his insolence.
Sorry, sir.
The captain said nothing, and he was right. But Bush, far from being satisfied, only waited for another opportunity to show his hate for me. This voyage made of me both a sailor and a merchant. During our first stop along the African coast, some natives came on board. They were anxious to trade with us. I exchanged a few cheap bracelets for some gold dust, an ordinary dagger for a beautiful pair of elephant tusks. And some old clothes that no one would have wanted, except possibly the moths who made their home there, for some exquisite pearls. To say that I had done good business would indeed be putting it mildly. Despite what my father said, I could never have made such a large profit with English tradesmen. Sometime later, we anchored off an uninhabited part of the coast, where the captain knew the location of some water holes. To stretch my legs, I went with the others to get fresh water. I believe every man who sees a desert for the first time experiences the same feeling of serenity I had. Silence, solitude, and peace. All was still. My companion and I decided to walk on without waiting for the second boat.
Now what do we do?
We're gonna save our skins, that's why.
What about the others?
Nothing we can do for them.
Roe!
But... Roe, I said!
But Robinson!
He was killed, is that understood? He was killed.
All right.
Robinson.
Dead.
Bush, assemble the men.
Yes, Captain.
Distribute the weapons and put the launch to sea.
There might be hundreds of them. We'll be massacred.
Captain, you're in command here. But to go on land now would be to commit suicide. What for?
You heard them say they were killed.
Are you sure they were massacred?
Aye, sir, they were. What's more, we were almost killed ourselves.
Poor Robinson.
Yes, poor Robinson.
So I had left England and broken my father's heart, only to find myself a wretched slave tied to a camel at the mercy of these barbarians. Their cruelty toward me was beyond measure, not because I was a slave, a foreigner, an infidel. No, they were cruel simply for the pleasure of being cruel. My rope and forced myself to continue walking. I don't remember very well my arrival at the Emir's camp. I was dying of thirst, weak from the burning sun and the whiplashes. I didn't even have the strength to think about the fate that awaited me. Were they going to torture me? Or kill me slowly by working me to death? Had the slyest, vainest, most impassive face I had ever seen. Or so it seemed to me. But then I was in no position to be objective. I must admit that the Emir had every reason to be in bad spirits. He had sent out an expedition to procure a great number of slaves. Many of his men had been killed, and the only slave brought back was a human wreck incapable of even standing up. Even to a bad businessman, it was obvious the venture was unsuccessful. He couldn't stand the sight of me. I was almost thankful when he had me thrown out. I was a miserable slave, but I had the company of men. Now, I'm king of a desert island. This comforting thought causes me to accomplish the primary duty of a king and a gentleman, to shave himself.
Your name is Polly. You're now the companion of Robinson Crusoe.
Huh?
A poor Robinson. You understand?
Huh?
Robin. Poor, poor Robinson.
To get rid of my somber thoughts, I organize a big work program for myself. I decide to capture a whole herd of goats. To start with, I prepare a comfortable shelter. I'll be able to milk my animals and thus always have milk at my disposal. I can't always catch the goats by running them down. I think I'll use a less exhausting method. In all the tales of adventure that I've read, animals were caught by simply digging pits across the game trails. In view of my other disappointments, I'm distrustful of their advice. I'll have to mark the position of this pit carefully so that I don't fall into it myself. For once, my adventure books didn't lie. My herd increases almost every day. Day and night, I keep a fire going on the highest point of the island to signal my presence to navigators. I look out to sea regularly, but nothing appears on the horizon. These constant disappointments serve only to increase my despair. It's perhaps at the very moment that I'm not looking at the sea that a ship is going to pass. And if I'm not on constant lookout, I might as well never watch. But this is faulty reasoning. I must try everything possible to be saved. I made a mistake in building my small fortress. I forgot that a dog can't climb a ladder, especially when he doesn't even want to try. Another mistake. The entrance of my cave isn't high enough and I bang my head constantly. At every meal, Dick and I bless the memory of the cook of the Esmeralda who had the foresight to lay in a considerable supply of salt pork.
Well, you still don't want to talk to poor Robinson? Come on, be nice. Poor, poor Robinson. You know what I mean, nice? Poor, poor Robinson.
With my goat and my dog, I was happy to have some friends to talk to. With my parrot, I thought I'd found a friend who could answer me. But he refused to cooperate. I fall too easily into the habit of living off the ship's stores. It's about time I restocked my pantry with fresh food. When I was a slave of the fishmonger, I used to observe carefully his fishing technique. I counted on my memory, my intelligence, and my ability to make as fine a catch as my old master. Once again, my pride was severely wounded. The fish seemed to sneer at me. They're wrong. The day will come when I'll succeed in catching them. Patience.